Did I switch my phone off now? How's the cough today? Okay, do I look okay?
Not the way I would like it to be.
No, no, say what, what was I doing? Yeah, my shave, no? Anything else? Must I take the scarf off?
Nothing wrong with you. But that's the way I know you, is like you are now.
But is there anything that I can do now?
No, yeah. It's supposed to be, you can't say now, so it's fine,
you know? Right, okay, fine. Okay. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah walhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa man wala wa ba'd. All praise and thanks is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Choices, peace, blessings and salutations upon our master, Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the third lecture in our series on usulul fiqh, the development of fiqh and the Islamic roots of fiqh. What is the subject all about and what are the various topics under the subject? This is our series of lectures that we're doing for this online university, inshallah ta'ala. And in today's topic, under Usulul Fiqh, or the Principles of Islamic Jurisprudence, we are going to specifically look at the Sunnah. Right? So in our first lecture, we discussed that Usulul Fiqh comprises of three major topics. The one being the Masadir al-Sharia, that is the sources of the law, right? And the sources of the law consist of the Quran, the Sunnah, Ijma', Qiyas, and various other things. And we've already discussed the Quran. It also discusses the methodology which is employed by the Mujtahid to derive the rules from the sources of the law. And it also discusses the descriptions or the qualities or the qualifications of the Mujtahid himself. So these are the three major topics of Usulul Fiqh, and I will repeat that throughout the lecture series, inshallah ta'ala, so that we can always put into perspective what it is that we are discussing now currently. This lecture on the Sunnah falls under the category of the sources of the law. So if you remember, in the first lecture we had the picture of the tree and the man picking the fruits from the tree. So the Sunnah would be part of the tree, right? We've already discussed the Quran, which is also part of that tree. This is the Sunnah. So in other words, what we are saying in this lecture is that the Sunnah is the second major source of law in Islam. Another way of saying it is that of the major sources of law in Islam, one is the Quran and the other is the Sunnah. And there are others as well. Now, the reason why I'm specifically saying that there's another way of saying it is that some scholars find it problematic to say that the Sunnah is the second source of law, as though it takes preference only after the Quran, when in reality, the Mujtahid will know that as a source of law, the Quran holds as much weight as the Sunnah holds, and the Sunnah holds as much weight as the Quran holds. Now, what does this mean? We are by no means saying that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is equal to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no. But as a source of law, the Quran, whenever it mentions something, whenever it commands or prohibits something, that prohibition and that command is the same as the command or the prohibition by Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is because the Quran gives him that authority. And this is what we will be explaining in this lecture, inshallah ta'ala. So in today's lecture, I'll be reading specifically from the book Understanding Usulul Fiqh, Studies in Usulul Fiqh, right? This particular book is written by Abu Tariq Hilal, right? Abu Ismail Al-Bayrawi. Abu Ismail Al-Bayrawi, and it's called Understanding Usulul Fiqh, and the subtopic is Principles of Islamic Jurisprudence, which is a general English translation for the topic. And this particular book has been published in New Delhi, right, by Revival Publications. And the topic of the Sunnah is going to be discussed from this particular book, inshallah ta'ala. The reason I've chosen this book for our discussion on the Sunnah is simply because I'm choosing to take a variety of sources in order to get a broad view of what the subject consists of. In other words, we're not going to stick to one particular book, but rather use several books so that we can see the perspective of several different scholars on this particular topic or on this particular subject. So, in our discussion today, dealing with the Sunnah, we're going to look at this book, Understanding Usul al-Fiqh, inshallah. Right, so we begin with the discussion officially. And normally, in all the works of Usul al-Fiqh, our scholars, the Mujtahidun and the Usuliyun, the scholars of Usul al-Fiqh, they would start by discussing the definition of the term. So when we say Sunnah, What do we mean by the term Sunnah? What does it mean, right? We've defined the Quran, now we're going to define the Sunnah. And it is also part of the tartib or the system of the scholars that when they define something, they first give the linguistic definition, in other words, the dictionary or the lexicon definition, and then they give the technical definition, the definition that is employed by the scholars of that particular subject. For example, in everyday life, when we say a chip, right? If you're speaking about a chip, if you define a chip, you can go to the dictionary and you will see that a chip would be, for example, a piece of potato that has been fried, okay? Another definition that you'll perhaps get is a chip, something that has been cut off of a tile or of a piece of rock, right? So the tile has been chipped. So these are all dictionary definitions. But if you speak to computer technicians and you ask them what is a chip, then they will give you a completely different definition. They will say that a chip is an integrated circuit that has various functions, you know, depending on what the chip has been designed for. So this is the difference between a linguistic definition and a technical definition. So the linguistic or the dictionary definition of Sunnah is as follows. Sunnah means a path or a way, right? A path or a way or a habit of someone. So when we speak of the Sunnah of Tariq, right? That would mean the habit of Tariq or the way of Tariq. Or when we say the Sunnah of a particular group of people, then we mean the habit or the practice of that particular group of people. An example of this usage is when the Prophet ﷺ said in a hadith, "Man sanna fil Islam sunnatan hasanatan, falahu ajruha wa ajru man amila biha min ba'dihi." The Prophet ﷺ said that whosoever practices or innovates a new practice within Islam, right, that is a good practice, then he will receive the reward thereof, as well as the reward of everyone who comes after him and also practices upon that particular habit. So this is the linguistic definition of Sunnah. It means a path, a way, a habit, or a practice of a particular person or a group of people. As a juristic term, right, as a legal term, Sunnah has different meanings, different technical meanings to different groups of people, right? In the same way that a chip means something completely different to a group of technicians, a group of computer technicians, and it means something completely different to tilers, for example. So for tilers, a chip means a chip on a tile, right? A taint or a blemish in the tile. But for computer technicians, a chip would mean this integrated circuit. So Sunnah, when you are discussing the term Sunnah with muhaddithun or scholars of hadith, it means one thing. When you are discussing Sunnah with scholars of usulul fiqh or the usuliyun, then it means something different. When you are discussing it with the fuqaha or the jurists, right, the scholars of Islamic law, then it means something else. So what are these different technical definitions of the Sunnah? Firstly, to the ulama of hadith, right, the muhaddithun, the Sunnah refers to all that is narrated from Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam in terms of his actions, his sayings or his statements or his utterances, and his tacit approvals. In other words, those things that was done in his company that was done and he was aware thereof and he didn't say anything about it. In other words, he approved of it tacitly. He didn't say, I reject this particular action, or he didn't even say that I commend this particular action. But when he remains silent on that action, then that is his tacit approval. So, it also includes all the reports that describe his physical attributes as well as his internal characteristics. So there's a holistic definition of the sunnah from the muhaddithun. Right. So what does this mean? This means that when you are speaking to a muhaddith or a scholar of hadith, then the term sunnah would specifically mean that which is attributed to Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in terms of his statements, his actions, his tacit approvals, his physical descriptions, and his internal characteristics. Okay. However, this term sunnah means something different to the fuqaha. In other words, the scholars of Islamic law or fiqh. The sunnah refers to an action that is praiseworthy, an action that will be rewarded if one does it, but will not be punished if one does not do it. In other words, it is mandub, this is a synonym for sunnah, for the fuqaha, or it is mustahab, right? These are all synonyms for the fuqaha, for the word sunnah. So when a faqih or a jurist or a book of fiqh says that something is sunnah, then what they mean thereby is that that particular action is praiseworthy, such that the person who does that action will be rewarded, but the person who does not do that action will not be punished, right? An example of this would be sitting down whilst drinking, right? So sitting down whilst drinking, if one sits down with the intention of following the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sunnah, then that action is called sunnah or mandub or mustahab, praiseworthy, such that the person who does it will be rewarded. But the person who stands and does not sit down will not be punished. That person has not done anything that is prohibited. So this is what sunnah means for the fuqaha or the jurists or the scholars of Islamic law. And it's very important not to confuse the two, right? So now we've got two definitions for the sunnah. One from the muhaddithun and one from the fuqaha or the jurists. Right. Now we move on to the scholars of usulul fiqh or the usuliyun, right? And this is of course the definition that we are concerned with in our discussion because we are dealing with the subject of usulul fiqh. So when an usuli or a scholar of usulul fiqh speaks about the sunnah, then what is he or she speaking of? The sunnah to scholars of usulul fiqh refers to another source of the sharia. It is a source of law along with the Quran, along with ijma or scholarly consensus, and along with qiyas or analogy. It is a source of law from which the mujtahid derives the fiqh. And this again will be a reminder for us of that picture that we drew in the first lecture on usulul fiqh, that picture of the tree, right? The tree represents the sources of the law, and one source of the law is the sunnah. The sunnah represents a body of information from which a scholar can derive the law of Islam. So how do we get to the knowledge of how to make salah, how to pay zakah, how to perform hajj, which acts are fard, right, compulsory, which acts are prohibited or haram, which acts are recommended or sunnah or mustahab? How do we know which are the shurut or the preconditions of the particular act? How do we know which are the arkan or the integrals of a particular act? All of this information is derived from the sources of the law, right? And then once it's derived, we open up our books of fiqh and then we see all of the law laid down for us. But the sources of the law contain the raw material, right? And they would be the Quran, the sunnah, ijma, qiyas, and a number of other sources. And when we speak about the sunnah in the framework of usulul fiqh, then this is what we are referring to. The sunnah as a source of law. Now, it is important once again that the definitions must not be mixed up, right? So when we say the word sunnah, then we need to ask the person using the word, under which context are you using this particular word? Do you mean sunnah according to the scholars of fiqh, sunnah according to the scholars of hadith, or sunnah according to the scholars of usulul fiqh? And once you know the context, then you know exactly which meaning they are referring to. So, Now that we've established the meaning of the sunnah in terms of usulul fiqh, we ask the question, who says that the sunnah is in fact a source of law? How do we know that the sunnah is that body of information that is officially a source of law in Islam, that the mujtahid must refer to the sunnah? In other words, why can't the mujtahid just refer to the Quran? Right? This is the question that we are going to answer now, inshallah. The question is answered by saying that the sunnah is a definitive source of law. Undoubtedly, a definitive source of law. This is agreed upon by all the scholars of Islam. From the time of the advent of Islam, or the time of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, till this very day of ours, there are no recognized scholars of Islam who reject the sunnah as a source of law. So, what is the proof of this? From the Quran, there are various verses, there are many, many, many verses from the Quran that establish the authority or the hujjiyah, right? The legal authority of the sunnah, right? That make the sunnah a legislative source of law. To give you some examples of these verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, مَن يُطِعِ الرَّسُولَ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهِ. Whomsoever obeys the messenger, so indeed that person has obeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What does this mean? This means that Allah has commanded the Muslims to follow the messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Therefore, when we follow him, we are automatically obeying the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whenever the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam commands something or prohibits something, then it is necessary for us as his followers to do exactly as he said. Why? Because Allah has commanded us to do that. And by obeying him, we have obeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So again, I'll repeat the verse. مَن يُتَعِ الرَّسُولَ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهِ. Whomsoever has obeyed the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, so indeed he has obeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this particular verse is derived from the Quran, Surah An-Nisa, right? Surah An-Nisa, and that would be the third surah of the Quran, and it would be verse number 80. So in Surah An-Nisa, verse number 80, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands that we obey the messenger of Allah. Another example of this, also from the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ. Allah says, and know by thy Lord, they will never ever ever believe. In other words, they will never ever have true iman until they make you, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, a judge regarding the issues and the disputes that arise between them. So here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making it absolutely clear and stating it unambiguously that iman will only be complete when we make the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam the official judge or the decider in all of our affairs and in all of our disputes, right? And this verse is also in Surah An-Nisa, verse number 65, right? Surah An-Nisa, verse number 65, Allah says, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ, no, by thy Lord, لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ, they will never ever truly believe, حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ, until they make you a judge, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, فِيمَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ, regarding all those things, those issues and those disputes which arise between them. So this is a clear-cut verse in the Quran that it is obligatory to follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And again, another example. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that everything that came from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was not from his own accord, but rather it was from inspiration, divine inspiration, directly from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So his words were not to be considered as human words, like the words of any other man, but rather as words that were inspired by Allah. And this is in the verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى. Allah says, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ, he does not speak anil hawa, from his own accord. In huwa illa wahyu yuha. It is nothing but divine revelation that is inspired to him, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this verse in Surah An-Najm, the surah of the star, and verse number 2 and 3, right? This is verse number 2 to 3, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that he does not speak of his own desire. Everything he says and everything he does is divine inspiration or wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, so this means that when the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam spoke, that we should take that, those words that he spoke, as a divine lesson from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that we have to obey those words. Another example of a command by Allah in which he establishes the hujjiyah, or the authority, the legal authority of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sunnah, is in the following verse. Allah ta'ala says, وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوهُ. That whatever the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam gives you, so take it. And whatever he prohibits you from, abstain from it. This verse, a very powerful verse, is in Surah Al-Hashr, verse number 7, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says unambiguously that everything that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam gives us, in other words, commands, prohibitions, recommendations, approvals, anything that he gives us, is to be taken definitively, because Allah commands it. Allah says, فَخُذُوهُ, take it, grab hold of it. وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ, and what he prohibits you from, فَانْتَهُ, then completely abstain from it. And this is proof that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam sunnah is a definitive authority for the scholars of usulul fiqh, for the mujtahidun, as a source of law. And then another example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالزُّبُرِ وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ. Okay, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, actually the verse should begin from this point, وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ. The part وَالزُّبُرِ is part of the first phrase, but the part that we are concerned with here is that Allah says, وَأَنزَلْنَا, and we have revealed, إِلَيْكَ, to you, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, الذِّكْرَ, the dhikr, the reminder. What is the reminder? The reminder, as the mufassirun, or the scholars of tafsir, tell us, this refers to the Qur'an. The Qur'an is the reminder. So Allah says, we have revealed to you, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the reminder, لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ, so that you can clarify it to the people. So here we are getting an idea, we are getting a instruction from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that one of the functions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is to teach us or clarify to us what the Quran says. What does this mean? Before I get into that, let me first say that this verse that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says here is repeated in different ways in the Quran, but this particular verse is from Surah An-Nahl. Surah An-Nahl, verse number 44, right? And in this verse, we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that a function of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is to make bayan, to clarify the meanings of the Quran to us. This is one of his functions. And how does this work, right? We're going to get into the details, but if you look at the command of salah, for example, in the Quran, Allah Ta'ala says, wa aqimu salah wa atu zakah, and establish salah and give zakah. But then we ask the question, how many salah should we perform? How should we perform salah? How should we know what is valid in the salah and what is not? What is an integral part of the salah and what is not? What should be recited in the salah, and when should it be recited? These details are not to be found in the Quran. So where do we find it? We find it from the sunnah of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the dhikr, or the Quran, tells us wa aqimu salah, establish salah, and the sunnah then makes bayan, or clarifies what that command means, and tells us exactly how to fulfill the rules and regulations of the Quran. Okay, so it is absolutely clear that the Quran establishes the authority of the sunnah. the last verse, and of course, this is only the last verse that I'm choosing to discuss in this particular lecture, but there are many, many verses that establish the authority of the Sunnah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Ali Imran, verse number 31, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبَكُمُ اللَّهِ. Allah Ta'ala says, say to them, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that if you claim to love Allah, then follow me, the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yuhbibukumullah, and then Allah will love you. So here we find that Allah suspends His love to us by following the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In other words, we can claim to love Allah, but Allah will only love us when we follow the sunnah of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is again absolutely clear that the sunnah is an authoritative source of law in Islam. Okay, now we've dealt with a number of verses, so we move on to the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in which he warns that the time will come when people will say that, you know, they only follow that which is in the Quran. And we find ourselves in times like that, where some people think that it is only necessary to follow what Allah says in the Quran, and that the Sunnah is not necessarily an authoritative source of law. So listen to the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he says, "Yushiku ayyaqooda rajulu minkum ala arikatihi yuhadithu bihadithi fayakul bayni wa baynakum kitabullah." فَمَا وَجَدْنَا فِيهِ حَلَالًا إِسْتَحْلَلْنَاهُ وَمَا وَجَدْنَا فِيهِ حَرَامًا حَرَّمْنَاهُ وَإِنَّمَا حَرَّمَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ كَمَا حَرَّمَ اللَّهِ. He says, soon a time will come when a person will be reclining on his couch and he will be quoting a hadith from me, in other words, from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he will say to the person who he will say to such a person, we have between ourselves only the book of Allah. What we find in it, we make halal, and what we find in it, we make haram. In other words, what the Quran makes halal, we make halal. What the Quran makes haram, we make haram. What the Quran allows, we allow. What the Quran prohibits, we prohibit. And that is all that we take. We don't take anything else. So then the Prophet ﷺ said, but this person should understand, whatever the Messenger of Allah has made haram or prohibited, it is like that thing which Allah has made haram. Why? Because whatever Allah has commanded, part of that is that you need to obey the commands of the Prophet ﷺ. And this is the words of Rasulullah ﷺ warning us not to be from among those who think that it is only necessary for us to follow the Quran. No, rather the Quran is an authoritative source of law, and so is the Sunnah of Nabi Muhammad ﷺ. And this, inshallah, will lead us to the next narration in which the Prophet ﷺ says the importance of keeping his Sunnah pure and untainted. He says, "Man balaghahu anni hadithun fakadhaba bihi." Whosoever hears a statement or some speech from me and then lies about it, or he rejects it completely, right? Then faqad kadhaba thalathatan, then he has rejected three things or three individuals. He has rejected Allah, because he rejected Allah's command by following the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He rejected wa rasulahu, he rejected his messenger. Walladhi haddatha bihi, and he also rejected the one who informed him of my statement. And this is a narration of Jabir radiallahu ta'ala an. So here we find that it is definitive that we cannot deny or belie the statements that is authentically attributed to Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And of course, what is authentically attributed to him and what is not is something that we need to discuss in this particular series of discussions as well. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam also said, "Ma taraktu shay'an mimma amarakumullahu ta'ala bih." I have not discarded or left out anything of what Allah has commanded. Illa waqad amartukum bihi, except that I have commanded you as Allah commanded. وَلَا تَرَكْتُ شَيْئًا مِمَّا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ, nor have I left out anything that Allah has prohibited. illa waqad nahaytukum anhu, except that I have indeed prohibited you from those particular actions. So we find that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling us that he has fulfilled his duty as a messenger of Allah, and he has fulfilled his duty by carrying out the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this leads us to the next part of our discussion inshallah ta'ala, where we will further look into what is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what does it consist of? Because now we know that it is an authority, but what does this authority consist of? So this will be the next part of the discussion inshallah. Okay. This part of the discussion takes us into the types of sunnah. We've now discussed the definition of the sunnah, that it is a source of law. We've discussed that it is an authoritative source of law based on the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, that it is a source of the mujtahid to derive fiqh from. Now we're going into the details of what does it consist of, right? The sunnah, for the usuli, for the scholar of usul al-fiqh, consists of the verbal statements of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In other words, qawl, his statements. Such as, for example, he who cheats is not one of us, right? The one who cheats is not one of us. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam said this, and it's recorded in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal radiallahu ta'ala an. And this is a verbal statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. What do we learn from this? We can learn several things, but for now we are just looking at it as one of the statements of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam. Again, he who cheats is not one of us. Then the second part of the sunnah, or the second branch of the sunnah for the usuli, is the fi'l, the action of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This consists of all the deeds and the practices of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, such as his salah, right? When the Sahaba radiallahu anhum used to look at him when he performed salah and describe his salah, those would be his actions. For example, if they would say that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to recite in every raka'ah, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. In other words, he used to recite the Fatiha. Or they would say, for example, that the Prophet ﷺ used to make ruku in a particular way, or sujood in a particular way, or he used to sit in this position or in that position. Another example would be Hajj. The whole description of the Hajj of Rasulullah ﷺ would be an example of his action or his fi'l. Then the third branch of the sunnah for the usuli is the taqreer, the tacit approval of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now this consists of the approval of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam if something was done in front of him and he didn't disapprove of it. Then this would be considered as an approval, a tacit approval. An example of this is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam approved the way the women prayed in the masjid, right? They used to pray at the back, separate from the men, but in the same space, in the same area. Another example would be the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would be sitting with one of the Sahaba, and he would be eating a dab, right, a desert lizard, and this would be halal. But the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam, when he was offered, he refused. In other words, he said that he does not want to partake. So he refused him for himself, but he didn't disapprove of it for the Sahabi that was sitting in front of him, and thus this would be a tacit approval. Another example of a tacit approval was that the Sahabi would say that we used to perform azl in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? Coitus interruptus, which is basically to stop intercourse before ejaculating. This practice took place in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He knew about it, and he didn't say that it was prohibited or that he disapproves of it. All of these are examples of his tacit approvals. So when we speak of the sunnah for the usuliyun, or the scholars of usul al-fiqh, it consists of three branches: the statements of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his actions, and his tacit approvals. All three consist of his practices, right? And the mujtahid will refer to these actions, statements, and tacit approvals and look for the law and then derive the fiqh therefrom. Okay. Now, the question is, how does the statements or the actions or the tacit approvals of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam reach us? Okay. He sallallahu alaihi wasallam lived in the 7th century Arabia for over 1400 years ago. We don't see him, we don't hear him, and we don't know of his tacit approvals because we are not living in his time. So how do we know that he said something? Or how do we know that he did something? Or how do we know that he approved of something? So, in other words, we need to ask ourselves, what is the vehicle of the sunnah to us? How does the sunnah reach us? Now, the way in which the sunnah has reached us is through what we call hadith. A hadith is a recording of the statements, the actions, and the tacit approvals of the Prophet ﷺ that was passed down from the Prophet ﷺ to the Sahaba who witnessed it. They then passed it down to the Tabi'een who heard it from the Sahaba. The Tabi'een passed it down to their students, the Atba'u Tabi'een, the followers. And they pass it down to their students, and they pass it down to their students, until eventually it was officially recorded in mass compilations, which we now know as the books of hadith, such as the books of Imam al-Bukhari, the Sahih Bukhari, or the book of Sahih Hadith by Imam Muslim, or the rest of the famous six books of hadith, that of Tirmidhi, Abu Dawood, An-Nasa'i, and Ibn Majah, radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in. These are not the only books of hadith, there are many books of hadith. But all of these books contain records, right, of the statements, the actions, and the tacit approval of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the way in which we know whether it is authentically attributed to him or whether it is not authentically attributed to him is an entire science on its own, known as Mustalahul Hadith or Ulumul Hadith, right? The sciences of Hadith. And in that science, one discovers how to authenticate whether these action statements and tacit approvals are actually authentically attributed to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because when it was passed down from him to the Sahaba, from the Sahaba to the Tabi'een, from the Tabi'een to their followers, this formed a chain of narrators or a chain of transmitters. This chain of transmitters has been recorded in the books of hadith. And the scholars of hadith will teach you exactly how to analyze these chains in order to find the authenticity thereof. Thus, hadith is a vehicle of the sunnah. Many students don't know what the difference is between a hadith and the sunnah, right? Because today it's used interchangeably. However, technically, now we know that the sunnah is the actual occurrence of the statements and the actions and the tacit approvals. And that hadith is the recording of those particular actions, statements, and tacit approvals that has been passed down through a chain of transmitters and is now recorded in the books of hadith. So this is something that you could go and study further in the science of ulumul hadith or the sciences of hadith. And of course, we don't have the time, nor is it the place to go into depth with regards to that particular science. But now we know how the mujtahid has access to those records of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's sunnah. Okay, the last part of our discussion is the nature of his statements and actions and tacit approvals. You see, some of the actions are part of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's being a human being. For example, the way he stood, the way he sat, the way he ate, the way he drank, right? For the way he walked, the way he slept, etc., the way he breathed. These are all parts of his habits as a human being, and the usuliyun strictly regard that these actions have no legislative impact. In other words, we don't derive law from this necessarily. Although if somebody wants to follow these actions out of love for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then that person may do so and that person will get rewarded. But we don't derive law therefrom because he was a human being and needed to do things the way humans do it. Okay, then of course, there are those actions that are specifically for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we also don't derive law therefrom, such as it was compulsory for him to pray tahajjud salah and to pray ishraq salah, right? Salat duha, in other words. It was compulsory for him sallallahu alaihi wasallam to do certain things that is not necessarily compulsory for us. And he was allowed to do certain things that is not allowed for us. For example, he was allowed to continue fasting throughout the night. In other words, to not break his fast at Maghrib. and to not eat until Fajr and then to continue fasting, we are not allowed to do that. The Prophet ﷺ had marriages that did not necessarily fulfill the integrals of marriage as we have to fulfill it. A woman could simply offer herself in marriage to the Prophet ﷺ and he could accept, and that would be a marriage. The Prophet ﷺ could marry more than four wives at a time, whereas we as his followers are not allowed to do that. So these are all examples of actions that are specific to him ﷺ. Then of course, the major part of his actions, and that is the ones, those are the actions that the Usuli or the scholar of Usulul Fiqh is concerned with. The actions which carry legal weight or legal consequences. These are the actions of the Prophet ﷺ, the statements and the tacit approvals that don't form part of the previous two categories. Okay? So, in what way does the Prophet ﷺ sunnah have an impact on the law? So, number one. Firstly, it provides an explanation for the Qur'an. Right? So the Qur'an says that salah is compulsory and the sunnah tells us how to perform salah. The Qur'an says zakah is compulsory and the sunnah tells us how to calculate zakah. The Qur'an says that fasting in the month of Ramadan is compulsory. The sunnah tells us how to fast in the month of Ramadan, what to stay away from. So the sunnah acts as an explanation for the Qur'an. That's the first role of the sunnah. Now, this is most certainly not the only role of the sunnah. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam had another function for his sunnah. Some of his acts fall under the category of those things that are recommended to do and those things that we consider to be praiseworthy. So mandub or nafl in the Arabic language. An example of this would be the 6 days of fasting in the month of Shawwal, or making special adhkar or ada'iyah at special occurrences, right? Or praying sunnah salahs. So we find that the Prophet ﷺ would teach us etiquette, in other words. So these etiquettes or these adab are derived from his sunnah. And then thirdly, the Prophet ﷺ would also do certain things which would simply show permissibility. For example, he would command that people would sit and drink. In other words, when somebody would stand and drink, he would tell the person to sit down. He would be very stern about this. But on one or two occasions, he himself would stand and drink to show that it is permissible. It is not encouraged, it is disliked, but it is permissible. So these are the different functions of the sunnah of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this is how the mujtahid will derive the law. So we ask ourselves the question, does the sunnah only clarify the Qur'an, right? Or does the sunnah act as a separate source of law that gives us original law? In other words, do we only look at the sunnah as an extension of the Qur'an, telling us how to do things that the Qur'an said we must do? Or are certain things established from the sunnah originally? And the answer is that the Qur'an, or rather the sunnah, acts as an explanation for the Qur'an and is also an original source of law, and that we cannot only take the sunnah when it is telling us about something of the Qur'an. So let us look for an example of this. In application, right? The sunnah can explain a word that is not explained in the Qur'an, and I've mentioned this before, أَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ. And then the Prophet ﷺ says, صَلُّوا كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِي أُصَلِّي. Perform salah as you have seen me perform salah. So now he explains it. Secondly, the Quran can mention something that's general, right? And that can be applied to any person, while the sunnah would specify who the term applies to and what the form of the law is. For example, the Quran says, أَزَّانِيَةُ وَالزَّانِي فَجْلِدُوا كُلَّ وَاحِدٍ مِّنْهُمَا مِئَةَ جَلْدًا. That the fornicatress and the fornicator, you should flog each of them with 100 lashes. But the rule can be applied to any male or female who is found guilty of zina. However, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would come to explain that those individuals who were previously married, and if they then commit zina, or while they are married, they commit zina, that the flogging doesn't apply to them, but rather the stoning applies to them. The flogging applies to those people who have never been married before. So the Sunnah explains it in that way. Thirdly, a rule may be mentioned in the Quran without any restrictions, but the Sunnah places restrictions on that rule. For example, the Quran says, وَالسَّارِقُ وَالسَّارِقَةُ فَقَطَعُوا أَيْدِيَهُمَا. The thief, both male and female, cut off their hands. There's no restriction in the ayah that tells us when somebody's hand should be cut off or under which circumstances. The Prophet ﷺ's sunnah tells us that there's certain restrictions on the application of the punishment, some of which are that the stolen property must equal a certain amount, right? If somebody steals something that was worth 10 cents, for example, right? Or it's worth a stone, for example, then a person's hand wouldn't be cut off for that. It has to be of a particular nisab or a particular value, which the Prophet ﷺ said is a quarter dinar or a quarter coin of gold, okay? And the property must be stolen from a place where such property or wealth is usually kept. The Prophet ﷺ would also indicate that if under average protection, right, this particular theft takes place, which is relevant to the people and the property itself. For example, if the jewelry is left in the open, right, instead of in a locked place, then the person who steals it will not have his hand cut off. But if the jewelry is in a locked place and the person then steals it from there, then the person's hand would be cut off. So again, the Sunnah tells us exactly how to apply the Quran. And then lastly, an original rule in the Quran, which is rather penultimately, not the last one, but the second last one, an original rule that is in the Quran, which is explained, right, has neither restrictions nor exceptions, but the Sunnah adds new items to the original rule. For example, the Quran would say that you are forbidden to marry your mothers, your daughters, your paternal and maternal aunts, your nieces, your foster mothers, in other words, your milk mothers, your sisters, your mothers-in-law, and your stepdaughters. But the Prophet ﷺ then adds to that list and he says, a man cannot get married to the sister of his wife, nor can he get married to the maternal or paternal aunt as well. So this is adding to what the Quran has already prohibited. And lastly, a rule that originates from the Sunnah that does not have any roots in the Quran. For example, the Prophet ﷺ said, "An-nasu shuraka'un fi thalath, al-ma' wal-kal wal-nar." The Prophet ﷺ said that people are partners in three things. In other words, they share three things: water, the kala' or the grazing for the animals, and fire, meaning, you know, power sources or fuel sources. So in other words, that these things are shared by all people. There's no essence or there's no root for this rule in the Quran. But the Prophet ﷺ sunnah comes to establish this rule as a completely separate entity. And another example would be the items of riba in trade. So if we study fiqh, we'll find that certain commodities such as dates and barley and wheat and salt are called ribawi commodities, or commodities in which the rules of riba are strictly applied. Now, this is a very technical law, which I don't have the time to explain in this lecture, but this law is established in the Sunnah and not in the Quran. The Quran only prohibits riba in the form of loans and stipulated positive returns on the loans. But the Sunnah tells us a different form of riba as well that has no origin in the Quran. So we see that the Sunnah has very vast forms of legislation. And it is up to the mujtahid to look at the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, to look at his actions, to look at his statements, to look at his tacit approvals, and to be able to understand whether it is an extension of the Quran, whether it is establishing a new law, whether it is commanding something for obligation, whether it is commanding something as a recommendation, whether it is showing that something is permissible, whether it is prohibiting something as, to not recommend it, or whether it is prohibiting something for a complete prohibition, as in to say it is haram. So this is a explanation of the Sunnah as a source of law. And these were some of the basic details of how the Sunnah can function as a source of law and how the Mujtahid can derive law from the Sunnah. And of course, there can be many, many more aspects that we could add to this discussion. But since this is an introduction to Usulul Fiqh, we will limit ourselves to those particular points under this topic, inshallah ta'ala. So I hope that I've clarified what the Sunnah is, what the function of the Sunnah is, why it is an authoritative source of law, how it acts as an authoritative source of law, and how the Mujtahid can derive law from that, inshallah ta'ala. So until next time, wa sallallahu ala Sayyidina Muhammad, walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.